Welcome to the SJC Senior School Debate Competition 2024. Today, we have three categories, each with their own unique topic. A topic is unique to the class debating it. As for the parameters of this debate, with each category, we have two teams of two, where one team will speak for and the other team will speak against the topic. One person from the for team will first take the stage and give a speech, which will then be followed by a rebuttal round. The original speaker will then have to respond aptly to the rebuttal. This will continue till all four speakers have had their go. Our dear debaters will be marked on their number one, content or subject matter, two, presentation and delivery of speech, three, confidence and the rebuttal round. The judges for this competition are Brother Lawrence, Brother Sato, and Brother Jerome. So please give them a round of applause. First on stage, we have students from class 9A and B. The topic for their debate is parenting is the toughest job today. Each speaker will have 3 minutes to give their speech, followed by 1 minute of a rebuttal round. Thank you. The four teams from class 9A are to be present.
Parenting is the only job which we get no training or no support for. We are just expected to do it. Sudha Murthy. Good morning to one and all present here. Today, I stand here before you to speak in favor of the topic, parenting today is the toughest job. Today, parents will do anything to make and keep their children happy. Children, on the other hand, are not expected to make any adjustments or compromise on anything. After the COVID-19 pandemic, parenting became even more tough. As the use of technology escalated during the pandemic, parents had to start worrying about their children's screen time, them not watching anything inappropriate on the internet, or them not getting cyberbullied. Another reason the parenting has gotten difficult is a new set of concerns about children's well-being. The parents simply has these concerns, but fears have changed over time. The parents of 90s and 80s used to worry about the children's physical safety, such as kidnapping or teen pregnancy. While these concerns still remain, they have been superseded by a new set of concerns, that ones about mental health. Most parents, according to the Pew survey conducted by the Pew University of Washington, D.C., said that they were worried their children would struggle with anxiety, depression, or face bullying. In conclusion, times have changed and so has our parenting. Parenting today is harder than ever, and the growing need to make ends meet in the fast expanding world has forced both parents to work. So, even with facilities such as online ordering, it has only given parents a bit of leverage. Thank you for your attention.
A very good morning to all of you present here today. I, Manas Joshi of class 9B, firmly oppose the motion that child parenting is the most difficult job. Though I understand how undeniably difficult raising children can be, but in my opinion, the notion of merely saying that child parenting is the most difficult job of all is overly pessimistic and fails to underline the unique opportunities and advantages that modern parents have. Firstly, advancements in technologies have offered parents new ways to impart education to their children, overall enhancing their learning experience. From interactive educational apps like Byju's and Vedantu to virtual classrooms provided by the likes of Zoom. Technology has offered us innovative tools to enhance and reverberate the experience of the students of today. Secondly, modern conveniences have simplified many aspects of parenting. With help from modern appliances, ready-to-eat meals, and online shopping, parents can save a lot of time and effort on mundane tasks. Whereas in the past, parents had to spend a lot of effort and time doing household chores, leaving them with less time for themselves. At this point, what more can the parents really ask for? They really need to consider that this is real life. You can't really have it on a silver platter. Moreover, today's society is more open and inclusive than it ever was. Diverse family structures are celebrated, and parents can find support and understanding inside their own communities, regardless of their backgrounds or their circumstances. This fosters an environment where the parents can share their triumphs and failures, building good networks based on encouragement and advice. Lastly, in the sector of healthcare, everything has been advanced. Vaccinations have improved the medical field, and better detection of childhood illnesses has removed the fears and stress of parents that they once faced over their children's health. In conclusion, there will always be challenges related with parenting, but it is not accurate to claim that it is more difficult than any other job. Instead, let us focus on the many opportunities and resources today's parents have. By embracing these advantages, we can and we will change the narrative and celebrate the journey of raising the next generation. Thank you.
Does anyone from the opposing team have any rebuttals for the previous speaker? Rebuttals? Anyone? Go ahead, take the mic.
So Manas, as you said in your speech, Vedantu and Baiju's help the parents. Vedantu had a recent scam where they scammed people of their money. Do you think you can trust Vedantu or Baiju's with their children, with your children, so that they don't teach them anything bad?
I believe your question is quite right, but the question was, but the scam exactly was about money, not about anything they taught. And see, it is real life. We need to consider there are scams everywhere. But the learning from Baiju's and Vedantu has resulted in many, many, many advancements in the knowledge of the students of today. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Next speaker.
So much is asked of parents, but so little is given. Virginia Saturn. Good morning, Brother Principal, Madam Headmistress, esteemed judges, my worthy opponents, and to one and all present here. Today, I, Arnab Gangola of Class 9B, am here to answer the question of whether parenting is the toughest job of our time. And I stand in firm affirmation that indeed, parenting in the 21st century presents challenges like never before, making it undeniably the toughest job of our time. First and foremost, let us discuss about the changing landscapes of technology. Parents are faced with the difficult task of controlling their children's screen time, exposure to inappropriate content, navigating the danger of cyberbullying, and the addictive nature that the screens bring with them. The constant struggle to find a balance between real-life interactions and technology is a problem that the previous generations never had to face. And just because of it, parenting becomes a much more difficult task. Moreover, let us discuss about the pressures presented by modern day society that have put immense expectations on the shoulders of parents. The need to excel in extracurricular activities, the pressure to excel in academics, and the desire to provide for a perfect childhood. All add a of difficulty to parenting today. Moreover, the problems related to modern day families have put another layer of difficulty to parenting today. Single parent households, blended families, and diverse family dynamics all require parents to navigate a myriad challenges that were not as prevalent in the past. The COVID-19 pandemic has further worsened the challenges of parenting. Parents have had to deal with many problems that were brought about by this pandemic, such as obesity in children, increase in screen time, etc. Social media and the proliferation of parenting advice from various sources has created a trend which leads parents to compare their child to other children. This is very wrong because every child is special in his own way. In conclusion, parenting in the 21st century is the toughest job given the pressures and challenges that modern day parents have to face. So, it is imperative that we recognize and appreciate the incredible work that the parents do in raising the next generation of our country. Thank you.
Okay, any rebuttals? Take the mic. Any rebuttals?
Aruna, as you said in your speech, that parents have to control the screen time. What do you think that if that screen time is actually for studies, then why should you stop your screen time if you are doing something good?
No. The screen time is not necessary all the time for studies. Sometimes children do various activities that is not good for them. So the children should be stopped from watching the screen too much.
Thank you very much. Next speaker.
Good morning, esteemed brothers, respected ministers, my dear teachers, friends, and all debaters present. I, Atyush Anand of Class 9A, stand on the stage while arguing against the topic of parenting today is the toughest job. Dear audience, I firmly believe that parenting, while undoubtedly important, cannot be regarded as the most challenging task in today's world. In this digital age, parents have access to a plethora of resources that can assist them in navigating the complexities of child rearing. The internet in particular is a treasure trove of information, offering countless parenting forums, blogs and articles filled with practical advice and tips. Additionally, there are numerous apps and countless online communities where parents can seek and gain guidance from others who may have faced similar challenges. Moreover, there are traditional upliftments in the roles of mothers and fathers. Gone are the days when parenting duties were solely the responsibility of one parent only. Nowadays, parents can
are you trying to ignore the important role that parents play
just by downplaying the parenting.
Can you please rephrase your question?
So Pranjeev, since you are against the topic of parenting is the toughest job of our time, so by your speech, are you trying to say that the roles of parents are not important just by saying that parenting has become easier?
No, I am not ignoring the roles of parents. But parents... Parents can also take information from the internet and they can always take help from there.
Okay.
Thank you very much. Now, my friend, my colleague will now be summarizing whatever the debaters here have said. Till then, I would like to request participants from class 10 to come on stage and take their places. The topic for their debate is, all schools should be co-educational. Again, this debate will have a time limit of 3 minutes with a 1 minute rebuttal round.
Thank you, class 9. In wrapping up our discussion on whether parenting is the toughest job in today's scenario, it's clear that there are valid points on both sides of the argument. While some believe that advancement in technology and support system alleviate the challenges of parenting, others emphasize on the complexities and the pressure parents face in today's society. Regardless of where one stands, it's crucial to acknowledge the diverse experience of parents and the unique circumstances they navigate through. Parenting undoubtedly presents its share of difficulties, but it also offers immense rewards and joys. Let's continue to appreciate and support parents as they strive to raise resilient, compassionate, and responsible individuals in our ever-changing world.
I'm sorry for the inconvenience, but I believe I have a rebuttal question for my patron. As I believe you said in your speech that parents today have done everything they can to make ends meet. But in my opinion, parents today are extremely careless, with most nuclear families having both parents that are working without giving any attention to their children. How do you think that affects the child, affects the life of the child?
If the parents don't give them enough attention, of course the child doesn't have such a good upbringing, but that doesn't make parenting a less harder job.
Like to repeat the topic. The topic for the debate is all schools should be co-educational. Again, the time limit here is as well as the last round is 3 minutes with 1 minute of a rebuttal round.
Education is the most powerful weapon which you can use to change the world. Good morning, respected brothers, teachers, and my dear friends. Today, I, Saksham Khanna of Class 10, stand before you to advocate for the continuation and promotion of co-education in our schools. Co-education, a system where both males and females study together in the same institution, is not just a concept. It's a cornerstone of modern education that fosters inclusivity and holistic development. First and foremost, co-education reflects the reality of the world in which we live. In our daily lives, we meet, interact, and communicate with people of all genders. Schools should mirror this reality, providing a natural environment for the students to encourage and interact with each other regardless of their gender. By breaking down gender barriers on an early basis, co-education prepares students for the vast, diverse, interconnected world they will step into after graduation. Furthermore, co-education nurtures a spirit of healthy competition. When boys and girls study together in the same institution, they are exposed to a wide range of ideas and perspectives. This diversity stimulates intellectual growth and encourages them to strive towards academic excellence. Co-education teaches the male and female students to respect and appreciate each other's achievements and success. Moreover, co-education promotes gender equality. It allows both male and female students to pursue their passions. Critics of co-education may argue that it may lead to mental disturbances and romantic entanglements. However, these facts are proven wrong when proper supervision is there. In fact, co-education teaches us valuable lessons of interpersonal relationship and respect for boundaries. In conclusion, co-education acts as a catalyst for social change and growth. As young leaders, we must strive to create co-education a pillar of our educational system. Let us strive to create an inclusive environment where every child, regardless of his or her gender, succeed and contribute meaning to the society. Thank you.
Any rebuttals? Take the mic.
How do you justify denying students studying in the same institution as it is responsible and very essential for developing social skills and confidence for today's diverse world? How can you prove this fact?
Well, Saksham, I believe single gender environment is better than co-educational environment because single gender schools focus better on how boys and girls learn differently, and also because students may face difficulties while studying in mixed gender environments as they might navigate through interpersonal relationships and dynamics.
Thank you. Next speaker.
Education breeds confidence. Confidence breeds hope, and hope breeds peace. Good morning, audience, esteemed judges, and my fellow debaters. I, Madhvendra Padusha of Class 10B, stand before you today to argue against the motion that all schools should be co-educational. While the concept of co-education may sound very appealing on the surface, it is important to recognize the potential limitations and drawbacks associated with this approach. In my opinion, one of the primary concerns associated with co-education is the increased potential for distractions and social pressure. In mixed-gender environments, students may face difficulties while focusing on their studies, as they might navigate through interpersonal relationships and dynamics. Secondly, boys and girls usually have very different ways of learning and understanding things. By accommodating a one-size-fits-all co-educational model, we might risk neglecting the educational requirements of each and every student. For instance, girls thrive in environments that promote collaboration and teamwork, whereas boys improve in environments that promote competitiveness with a more hands-on approach. By segregating genders, we can tailor teaching methods to better accommodate the educational requirements of each and every student. In conclusion, while the concept of co-education may sound very egalitarian on the surface, it is crucial to recognize the potential limitations and drawbacks associated with this approach. Let us embrace the richness of education and support the continuation of both single-gender and co-educational schools to ensure that the educational requirements of our student population is met. And also, by preserving the option of single-gender education, we honor the principles of diversity, inclusivity, and freedom of choice. Thank you.
Any rebuttals for this round?
Saksham, how do you plan on dealing with problems such as distractions and peer pressure in mixed-gender environments, considering your support for education?
Well, distractions can be anywhere, but once we talk about co-education, it offers an inclusive environment where both male and female genders get together, communicate with each other, get along with new perspectives and ideas, and prepare for the diverse connected world they will step into after graduation. In fact, these reports have been proven by many surveys of OECD, American Association, of 2005.
Thank you very much. Next speaker. Greetings to one and all present here. Today, I am Rahul Bhatt of Class 10B and here to talk about the topic of co-education. In the favor of the motion, I would like to bring to the attention of all that the system of co-education is not only a better option, but also a necessity in the modern society, where we not only see that many students brought up in single-gender schools are unable to express themselves freely to the other gender, but also the alarming harassment rates in the country. Co-education can provide an effective way to tackle both of these challenges by promoting teamwork capabilities in the students and fostering mutual respect for the genders. It plays a key role in preparing the future generations for the real world, as in the real life, both genders work together in the same conditions. Moreover, it can play an essential role in preparing them for teamwork capabilities, and it also promotes healthy competition and collaboration, which are essential components of personal and professional success. Such an environment also promotes the ideas of innovation, creativity, and creative thinking skills in the students, which are once again important parts of success. Critics of co-education often express concerns regarding distractions and inappropriate behaviors. However, it is essential to recognize that such issues can arise in any educational setting, and they are not inherent to co-education. To conclude, I would like to say that co-education is not merely an educational model. It is a catalyst for social change and progress by fostering inclusive learning environments, promoting healthy competition and collaboration, and challenging gender stereotypes. Co-educational institutions pave the way for a more equitable and just society. Let us embrace co-education as the cornerstone of our educational system and motivate the students to become compassionate and critical thinkers who are ready to tackle the challenges of the future. Thank you. Any rebuttals for this round?
As you mentioned in your speech about harassments within single-gender schools, I can't understand how many mentioned it in single-gender schools. Instead, it is at an alarming rate in co-ed institutions.
To answer your question, first of all, same-sex harassment is not a new topic. In fact, it has been prevalent for the last few years. And moreover, I wasn't talking about harassment in single-gender schools or co-educational schools. I was talking about in the outside world. And co-education promotes it reduces the chances of students committing such crimes by fostering mutual respect for the genders in the minds of the students.
Thank you very much. The final speaker.
Once the Greek philosopher Plato said, the direction in which the education of a person will start will determine his whole future. Good morning, esteemed judges, respected teachers, and my fellow debaters. I, Randhir Singh Mehra, stand before you all to argue against the establishments of co-ed institutions. While the idea of co-education may seem to be appealing at the first glance, but it comes with a host of challenges and drawbacks that cannot be ignored. First and foremost, the presence of both the genders in the same classroom can lead to distractions and disruptions, hindering the learning process for all the students. Adolescence is a critical time for academic development, and the introduction of opposite gender into the learning environment can create unnecessary social pressures and tensions, detracting from the primary goal of education. Furthermore, co-ed schools often fail to address the unique needs and learning styles of boys and girls. Researchers have shown that boys and girls tend to excel in different subjects and in different ways. So by segregating them into single-gender schools, we can better cater to the diverse needs of the students and provide them a more inclusive environment. Additionally, co-ed schools can accidentally perpetuate gender stereotypes and inequalities. In mixed-gender environment, the boys and the girls may be encouraged to conform to traditional gender roles, limiting their potential and stifling their interests and ambitions. Single-gender schools, on the other hand, provide a more inclusive and empowering environment to all the students, where the students are free to explore their interests and abilities without any fear of judgment or discrimination. In conclusion, I would like to say that co-education, the establishments of co-educational institutions may seem to be like a step towards gender equality, but in reality it is doing more harm than good. By maintaining single-gender schools, we can better cater to the diverse needs of the students, minimize distractions, and provide an empowering environment to all the students. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Any rebuttals for this round?
So, Ranveer, as you said in your speech, and I agree with the fact that different genders have different environments in which they excel academically. But in my opinion, for educational schools, learn teach students to adapt to the surroundings, while single gender schools are pampering them by giving them all the things they want and need at the time. So how do you justify this pampering?
How come pampering comes here? Single gender schools just provide a focused learning environment to all the students, addressing their unique needs and learning styles, and by giving them various opportunities and responsibilities, so they can foster their confidence and leadership skills to be used in real life. So there is no pampering.
Thank you very much. Next up, class 12. But before that, a brief summary.
Thank you, class 10. In conclusion, following a thorough debate on whether all schools should adopt co-education, it's evident that both sides have presented compelling arguments. Advocates for co-education highlighted its potential to promote inclusivity, social skills, and the breakdown of stereotypes. Conversely, opponents expressed concerns regarding potential distraction, differing learning style, and the value of single-gender environment for certain students. Ultimately, the diverse needs and preferences of the community. By upholding the principle of inclusivity, diversity, and the comprehensive development of students, regardless of the outcome, fostering an education environment that values respect, collaboration, and equitable opportunities for all learners remain crucial. Now, finally, it's time for the class 12. They have a topic: unregulated AI is more dangerous than climate change. In this round, each speaker will have 4 minutes to give their speech, followed by 1 minute of a rebuttal round.
Divyan Bhandari, 12. The motion placed before us today is unregulated AI is more dangerous than climate change. And I will be speaking for the motion. Be wary, for it only takes 2 words for the helping hand to become the hand that hinders. AI was developed as a mere machine learning tool. It has now become our associate, and in no time it will become a leader or perhaps a dictator. There exists a rat race to oversimplify the procedure of development of new AI. This gives opportunity to new and immature AI enthusiasts and developers to create AI according to their own convenience without any restrictions. These works are full of defects and loopholes, which most definitely will lead to an anomaly, which is likely to be life-threatening disease. The only difference in it is it is not concentrated to one Chinese lab. It exists globally. A big thanks to the open source. Presently, AI should not be considered as a harmless and mere machine learning tool. It is a digital species which possesses high intelligence and continues to evolve. It has access to large quantities, if not all, the data present in servers all around the world. AI is known to create deep fakes, spread misinformation, and unregulated one with all the information at its disposal. It's capable of creating such realistic rumors, hate speeches, and propaganda, which are really, really concerning. A certain criteria of deception is also integrated in the code of various AIs, which help them to hide the behavior that the creator does not want. Enslavement by AI is a realistic scenario that the world faces today. How will you act against climate change when you don't have the free will to do so? Enslavement takes away that free will of ours. When this AI dictator of yours will not allow you to breathe at your own will,
to tackle climate change when the necessity means to do so will be snatched away? Should we be worried about the generation of tomorrow when our own existence is on the line? The temperature rises at about 0.17 degrees Celsius per decade, and Earth is still far from becoming an uninhabitable planet and causing existential crisis. Dreaming on the future is useless when you can't save your present. However likely or unlikely you personally believe the existential threat from unregulated AI is, it is indisputable that it does and will exist, and will only foster to become a greater problem to the point where it cannot be solved if it is not addressed as a risk of top priority now. Thank you. Any questions?
You mentioned that AI could be a reason for enslavement. Can you name any 5 AI tools which have the potential to replace humans at present?
See, it is still a possibility that AI, it is still a hypothetical possibility, I would say, that AI will enslave humans, okay? But when has these hypothetical risks not become a reality? Colonizing Mars was a hypothetical possibility, but it is happening now, right? Isn't it? Thank you.
Madhav Vashish, class 12. The proposition before us today is unregulated AI poses a greater danger than climate change. I will be speaking against the proposition. Climate change refers to long-term shifts in temperature and weather patterns. Human activities have been the primary factor that drives climate change. Now let us examine the key dangers that are presented by climate change. First, climate change and rise of poverty. The planet has lost around one-third of its arable land in the previous 40 years, in large part due to climate disasters. More than 1.3 billion people live on mainly agricultural land, putting them at risk of hunger, poverty, and displacement. Natural disasters have become more frequent and destructive. In 2019, 396 events, more than the annual average over the previous decade, affected 95 million people globally and caused $103 billion in economic losses. Secondly, not enough food to climate change. Worldwide yields are expected to fall by up to 20% by the year 2050, according to the State of Food Security and Nutrition in World Report. More than 750 million people experienced extreme food insecurity in the year 2019. Rice yields in India are expected to fall marginally by less than 2.5% between the years 2050 to 2080, and indicated rice yields by 7%. Further, wheat yields are expected to reduce by 6 to 25% by the year 2100, and maize yields by 18 to 23%. The declining food production is met with a booming population increase, which cannot be sustained. If this trend continues, widespread famines would become a common occurrence, which would affect the entire world, especially India, which holds the world's largest population. Again, artificial intelligence, or AI, is yet to present some pressing issues. Artificial intelligence, or AI, refers to computer systems capable of performing complex tasks that historically only a human could do, such as decision-making or solving problems. However, AI is not truly an intelligence. AI is a collection of algorithms that are taught how to respond to data that is fed to them either by us humans or by devices that we have created. The AIs do not think like we do. The AIs are just useful tools to free humans from the drudgery of doing things. AI is still a very new concept. It is still in its developmental phase, meaning that any possible dangers it may possess can be prevented or fixed. Climate change is a reality, which is backed up by a lot of evidence, and its biggest evidence is is that we all can see it happening around us. Andrew Ng, the co-founder and head of Google Brain and the former chief scientist at Baidu, told the Australian Financial Review in an interview that large tech companies are creating a fear in the minds of people that AI will exterminate humanity. But the matter of fact is that these big companies are only doing so that they may gain monopoly in the field. Finally, I will conclude by saying that climate change might eliminate the human race. So even if AI is to enslave humanity, the climate change will make that point mute. There will be no humans to rule over. Thank you.
You speak of that climate change is a long-term effect. So how is it going to affect us in the next summers? Are we going to be concerned about our ice creams melting? Or should we be concerned about this AI becoming conscious now?
Let us say that climate change is a more immediate threat. As we can see, the day before yesterday, a massive forest fire broke out near the Hawaii region, and especially near my house. And it was so terrible, the flame was so terrible, that military had to intervene for 2 days without a break. They tried their best to extinguish the fire. So what's more dangerous? The flames that are created by climate change burning us, or a possibility of an, let's say, conscious AI, which is not backed by any evidence. So, thank you.
Please follow.
Sure.
And today I will be speaking for the motion that unregulated AI poses a greater threat than climate change. Firstly, I will address Madhav's claim of global sea levels rising by 0.9 feet in the next century or so, and global average temperature rising by 0.2 degrees Celsius in the next decade. Secondly, I am not here to talk about hypothetical situations that may happen in the next century or 700 to 800 years. I am here to talk about things that are happening right now. I am here to talk about the thousands of multinational firms that have laid off more than 30% of their employees as AI is simply more efficient. I am here to talk about millions of employees around the world that fear for their livelihoods as AI continues to outperform humans in multiple fields. I am here to talk about by how 2030, nearly half of all the jobs in the Indian market alone will be disrupted by AI. Despite the pessimist narrative created around climate change and all the data, my friend Madhav and I will scare you with, climate change is quite honestly slowing down. The coal consumption of developed economies has plummeted in the recent years. Renewable energy has become 10 times cheaper. The ozone hole is on its way to complete recovery. The rate of melting of glaciers has slowed down. 10 years ago, this would have seemed like wishful thinking, a fever dream. But today, this is our reality. If 2 years ago, somebody would have told me how popular electric vehicles would become in the next 2 years, I would have frankly not believed them. But today, we can only expect the number of electric vehicles to rise, and we can expect more electric vehicles roaming around our school gates or be parked outside the gates of Dolzin. Yes, climate change was a threat that we have tackled by its root. We came together as a society, and with the help of global regulations tackled it. We as a society are leading ourselves into a more sustainable future. AI, on the other hand, has evolved from a simple tool to a complex system entirely capable of replacing humans in the fields of bookkeeping, journalism, graphic design, programming, etc. Jeffrey Hinston, whose work in the fields of machine learning has earned him the title Godfather of AI, he clearly stated, and I quote, that AI might end up being more dangerous than climate change. Another popular argument for artificial intelligence is that AI will bring more jobs than it will replace. Yes, absolutely, it will bring more jobs, But those jobs, what the opposition fails to mention is that those jobs will be blue-collar jobs, which will leave us humans to the drudging works, whereas AI itself will take the white-collar jobs, which will leave us with a poorer class and will lead to an economic unrest. So what do you want? Working your fingers to the bone, mining for lithium in a cave, or a better future where we can envision ourselves with better jobs in a programming field? This brings me to the end of my debate. If you wish for the latter, we will need to implement global regulations and lastly agree that AI is indeed more dangerous than climate change. Thank you. Any questions?
You mentioned in your speech that climate change, the rate of climate change is being reduced, right?
Yes.
So my question is that how come such a terrible forest fire broke out in the Bhavani region, which like could destroy the entire pine colony? So I want your comments on that.
Exactly. We are currently tackling the situation around the climate change. It has only been around 40 to 50 years that we have implemented policies that help us enforce the climate change policies. But now those regulations are springing into action, and we can envision a better future. Thank you.
May I follow up?
Sure.
So you speak of like climate change regulations. However, it is a noticeable fact that such regulations are not being followed, and yet there is no progress at all. We can see like red temperatures rising. This is the first time I have witnessed Nainital in such a hot temperature. So how can we say that climate change is being reduced in effect? Please comment.
So firstly, in third world countries or developing countries, the protocols are not being followed, that I agree. But in already developed countries like UK and US, their coal consumption has reduced by 20%. That's an absolutely crazy fact that you should know.
One more, just last.
Sure.
Yeah. So you say that like developing countries are not putting forward like climate change regulations. My argument to that is, developed countries like USA, UK and China exhibit at least 10 times more carbon emissions than the underdeveloped countries or developing countries.
But they are being reduced, that's what my previous statement was.
Can you please repeat?
They are being reduced, the coal consumption is being reduced, and we are heading into a more sustainable future with electric vehicles and other such adjustments.
Alright, thank you.
My best class 20. Today I stand here to deliver my thoughts against the motion, unregulated AI poses a greater threat than climate change. The majority of global warming has occurred since 1975 at a global rate of 0.2 degrees Celsius. And besides this, climate change related disasters can affect a person's mental well-being, from the disruption of communities to loss of livelihoods due to any natural calamity can trigger psychological anguish, anxiety, depression, and even post-traumatic stress disorder. To address the point that the opposition said that AI is still hypothetical and it could turn out to be true, for that, let's delve back into history. Did the innovation of calculators replace mathematicians? Well, I can see too much teacher over here. Well, and considering the invention of computers around 150 years ago, can we make even a single progress in today's world without the help of computers? After hearing both the negative aspects of unregulated AI as well as climate change, it is pretty fair to consider the worst case scenario of either of them. Starting with unregulated AI. At its worst, unregulated AI could be a reason for unemployment. It could saturate the internet with deepfakes. And let's say it could have a significant contribution in cybercrime. But on the other hand, climate change at its extreme straight away leads to end of more than 700 species on Earth, including humans. And as humans, we should prioritize our life over anything else. If people consider still that climate change is curable, then a city like Bengaluru, which used to be the city of lakes, is now facing water crisis. Isn't that a concerning point? So to conclude, I would say, blaming a tool like artificial intelligence just because of hypothetical risk isn't fair. Instead, we should unite and tackle the tangible consequences of climate change, which poses a great threat to the existence of humanity and require immediate global action. Thank you. Any questions?
In your argument, you state that computers only lead to more jobs being developed. But have you ever seen the likes of AI before? Have you ever seen completely new and creative images or graphics being created before?
See, these are generated by the beta versions and not tested by humans till now. In some cases, you could consider it as true. But on the other hand, companies generally use this classical technique of marketing to overpromise and underdeliver.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you everyone for your thrilling performances. And a very special thank you to our tabulators, Ms. Gurrani and Ms. Meera Bhatt, who will now be tabulating the results. Till then, my friend here will give you a brief summary followed by a musical performance by Vedic Virat Joshi of class 10B.
Thank you, class 12. In conclusion, the debate has highlighted the significant risk posed by both unregulated AI and climate change. Unchecked AI development could lead to societal disruptions like job displacement and privacy breaches, as mentioned by the speakers, while climate change threaten us with extreme weather events, environmental degradation, and our very own existence. Balancing innovation with regulation is crucial. Addressing these challenges require proactive policy making, interdisciplinary collaboration, and public engagement. By prioritizing informed decision making, we can navigate through the complexities of unregulated AI and climate change, working towards a safer, more sustainable future for all.
Yesterday, all my troubles seemed so far away. Now it looks as though they're here to stay. Suddenly, I'm not half the man I used to be. There's a shadow hanging over me. Oh, yesterday, came suddenly. Why did she have to go? I don't know, she wouldn't say. I said something wrong.
Esteemed guardians, Brother Jerome, Brother Sato,
Madam Raza, respected teachers, the support team, student support team, you helped us, and my dear young students who are sitting there as spectators. I felt as though I was sitting in a battle arena. Observing our young wordsmiths and advocates expressing themselves with such clarity, with their insightful analysis and a shared sense of respect. And I'm genuinely inspired at how each argument brought us closer to understanding, at how each counterpoint brought us closer towards clarity. First of all, I would like to thank our organizers, Ma'am Knight, Ma'am Best. Students, can you please put your hands together and give them a clap? Also, Ma'am Howard. Thank you, dear teachers, for choosing such stimulating topics. The debate was really a battlefield, and I'm sure our students enjoyed listening to the debate. Dear teachers, your dedication to nurturing the intellectual growth of our students is invaluable. Thank you so much once again. To the students who took part in the debate, showing exceptional skills in arguing and critical thinking, I offer you my sincere congratulations. Once again, please put your hands together for the students. Their confidence, their quick thinking has been truly impressive, representing the art of debate with skill. To all the students sitting here, in today's world where information and opinions come so easy, the ability to think critically is so important. Debate is not just proving your own point. It is about listening closely, thinking quickly, and responding in confidence. And that's what will make a lasting impression. May you always have the courage to listen attentively, think critically, and engage in respectful conversations. So I repeat the four aspects, students, here. Listen, what's the word? Listen closely. What? Listen?
Closely.
Think quickly. Repeat it.
Think quickly.
Respond confidently.
Respond confidently.
And the last words are respectful conversations. Okay, so please follow this. In closing, I leave you with words of Winston Churchill. Courage is what takes to stand up and speak. Courage is also to sit down and listen. Thank you, and once again, congratulations to our organizing team and all the students who participated in the debate. Thank you.
The time is finally here and the results are in. And for that, I would like to humbly request Brother Jerome to come on stage and announce the results. Thank you.
Thank you, Brother Lawrence, for all those words of encouragement. We now announce the winners. Just before we announce the winners, I would also like to thank the teachers who took trouble to organize the debate, all the participants who came and who took part in the debate, who shared their views. Next time we hope to see many others taking part in this debate. So thank you once again. Thank you to the compere. Thank you to the boys who sang the lovely songs and entertained us. So without any further delay, I will ask Mrs. Ebaraza to call out the winners of the debate competition.
Good morning, everyone. From classes 9, best speaker for Arav Gangola. Best speaker against Manas Joshi, 9B. Winning team, Ram Bansal and Arnab Gangola. Class 10, please. A round of applause.
we congratulate all the winners.